So this morning, I want to speak a little bit differently than what I normally share. And I want to speak about Jesus, the Son of God. Jesus, the Son of God. I wonder if our natural mind will ever really comprehend who this Jesus really is and what he was like and what he was thinking about and what he was on about while he walked the streets of this earth. Jesus was an amazing man. He just loved people so much. He just loved everybody so much. But when he walked on this planet, he walked as a servant. Remember a couple of weeks ago, I talked about him cooking the disciples' breakfasts. He walked as a servant and he came to serve and he came to save and he came to lay down his life. I believe that Jesus, when he was walking on this planet, was the most misunderstood human. They did not understand him. They couldn't work him out. They couldn't fathom what he was about. And sometimes we, now on this earth, as we understand the Son of God, and you know, we know that as he hung on that cross, he could have called down 12 legions of angels. He could have done a lot of things, but that he didn't do. It's what he did do is what we're interested in. He gave himself and he loved people. Hebrews chapter 12 verse 2 says this. It says, looking unto Jesus, the author, which means the originator and the finisher or the perfecter of our faith. That's what Jesus wants to do. He's the originator. He's the one that comes to touch us. He wants to perfect our faith. Sometimes we go through some things that God never meant for us to go through, but in it, he wants us to learn that we can grow and we can develop and triumph over the devil. So looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher or the perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. Father, I pray today that we as a people would catch a glimpse of the Savior of the world. My God, we would see him as you want us to see him. Lord, we would understand that when he came with a purpose, and Lord, he fulfilled that purpose. He came, my God, to fulfill the requirements that we might not understand, but something that was done and established in the heavens when man fell, that God had a plan to destroy the works of Satan, and Jesus came to fulfill every requirement, and he gave his life that we might be free. And Father, for that, we'll give you all the praise and give you all the glory. Jesus' walk on earth was a walk of love and compassion. He poured his life into people. If they were hungry, he fed them. If they were sick, he healed them. He met every need. The Bible says, "My God shall supply all of your need according to his riches in glory." He met every need mankind would ever have. Friend, today, if there's a need, if there's something around your life, friend, Jesus has met that need. It's already been met. And in fact, what really was going on, Jesus went about doing good. It says in Acts 10:38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, who went around doing good, healing all who were oppressed of the devil, because God was with him. He went around touching people. He released his father's heart. And the sad thing was that as Jesus was doing all these things, this is why they wanted to kill him. As he revealed the Father, as he revealed the true reason for for us coming to our God. A lot of people didn't want to come the way he wanted us to come. They wanted their own power. They wanted their own rights. But when he showed the Father's heart, all he was doing was going around healing and doing good, and they killed him for it. They showed him no mercy on the whipping pole. As he hung upon that pole and the whip would bite into his flesh and tear great chunks of flesh, the man that was scourging him was a professional. If he didn't do the job right, he most surely would have got destroyed himself. But as a professional, he had to lay that whip in. And as that whip went in and was just destroying that body, he was hanging there. But in reality, he was paying the price for every sickness and every disease that would ever come upon the face of this earth. The crowds he fed cried out, "Crucify him!" Friends, sometimes you've got to walk in the shoes of another person to understand what was really going on the inside. Because if we're just looking from afar and we can just look at this and say, yes, well, praise God, he died for me. But friend, I want to tell you, it was more than that. The anguish, the agony that he would have been going through as he came to this planet to show forth the glory of God and the presence of God and the love of God and who God really was. That now these people that he'd fed, that he'd healed, that he'd delivered, are crying out, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Because they've been stirred up by an angry mob. The 12 men who he took under his wing forsook him. They didn't understand it because they had their own program. They had their own thinking. You know, one of the biggest problems, friends, is when we sit sometimes and we're going through things, our mind goes ravishing crazy and says all these stupid things to us, and we just get caught up in our own thinking. Instead of somehow or other thinking about who he really is and what he really, 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 really means to us. And what he's really, really done for us. And how he hung on that cross that you and I would be free. Friends, sometimes we're just victims of our own thinking, wrong thinking. The 12 who he took under his wing, ones that land on his breast, the ones that said, "We will never ever leave you. If you're going to die, we'll die with you." All of a sudden, he says, before the rooster crows, "You will deny me 3 times. Even after the crucifixion, Peter says, "I'm going fishing." Their hope was gone. They were lost. In the natural, as Jesus looked down from the cross, he could see people that he loved and that he really cared for gnashing their teeth, shaking their heads in disgust, cursing him. I wouldn't blame Jesus for 1 second if he wouldn't have called fire down from heaven and consumed every one of us. I don't know about you, but I deserve that. I didn't deserve the love of God. Did anybody here deserve the love of God? But while we were yet sinners, he loved us. Amen. Cursing him. Seeing all these people, the way they were reacting. Could not blame him for thinking all was lost. "I've come to touch this people, but they're just gnashing their teeth at me. They're shaking their heads. They're cursing me. They're mocking me. They're walking away from me. Did I come in vain?" And finally, it seemed as if God himself abandoned him. That caused him to cry out, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Yet even in this tragic time, Jesus continued to impact lives. Even in death, Jesus displayed the character and the love of Christ, the love of his God. Amen. I want you to open up your Bibles to the book of Mark. Mark chapter 15, 22. And they brought him to the place Golgotha, which is translated place of a skull. Then they gave him wine mingled with myrrh to drink, but he did not take it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his garments, casting lots for them to determine what every man should take. Now it was the third hour, and they crucified him. And the inscription of his accusation or his crime was written above, the King of the Jews. With him they also crucified two robbers, one on his right and the other on his left. So the scripture was fulfilled, which says that he was numbered with the transgressors. And those who passed by blasphemed him, wagging their heads and saying, "Ah, you who destroyed the temple, you who destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross." Likewise, the chief priests also mocking among themselves with the scribes, these were the religious people, said, "He saved others, himself he cannot save. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, descend now from the cross, that we may see and believe." Even those who were crucified with him reviled him. Now when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani," which is translated, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Some of those who stood by, when they heard it, said, "Look, he is calling for Elijah." And someone ran and filled a sponge filled with sour wine, put a reed and offered it to him to drink, saying, "Let him alone. Let us see if Elijah will come to take him down." And Jesus cried with a loud voice and breathed his last. Then the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. So then the centurion who stood opposite him saw that he cried out like this and breathed his last. He said, "Truly, this man was the Son of God." Father, I pray that every one of us would somehow or other catch a glimpse of what the thief and the centurion saw. That we too might be able to cry out and say, "Truly, this one is the Son of God." And Father, for that we give you all the praise and all the glory. Amen. In Luke 23, 46, what Jesus cried out that caught the attention of the centurion was this: "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." Having said this, he breathed his last. He also cried out at one stage, "It is finished. My earthly ministry is finished." He fulfilled the requirements of the law. Now Jesus was no longer the Son of Man, but the Son of God. No longer bound by whatever restrictions were put upon him. Jesus just continued to show forth. In Mark 15, 22 to 39, in this passage we see the thieves hanging on either side of Jesus, along with the crowds. These thieves mocked and persecuted him. In crucifixion, all your joints are disjointed. The weight of your body puts pressure on your chest, squeezing air out of your lungs till you suffocate. I started to read these scriptures and I could not get out of my mind while Jesus was going through all this, we were still on his mind. If we're hanging from a cross and the pressure on our lungs that we can't breathe and we're suffocating, and they say that with his feet, then he'd push up a little bit to take the pressure off his lungs until the pain in his feet was so bad that he'd have to fall back again under the weight on his arms, and then again the chest would begin to suffocate him. And as this was going on, that somehow or other he wanted to get these words out. I can't, in my natural mind, I can't comprehend it, but I tell you what, I started to get a fresh understanding how much God really loves us, how much Jesus really loves you, how much he died for you, and we can just palm him off like as if we were playing a game of football and say, I might find him later on or something else. Friend, we should run to the cross of Calvary. We should fall at his feet and humbly beseech him to come into our lives. And here he is, he's there, and he knows the sin of humanity, and he knows what's going on because they're crucifying the Christ. And somehow or other inside his body, he just conjured it up and he cries out, "Father, forgive them." That's how much he wants you and I to understand his love for us. And the price he paid for us, that even in that agony and anguish and the rejection and everything seeming lost, he still cries out, "Father, forgive them. They know not what they do." I think every one of us today, somewhere along the line, have got to say and hear Jesus say, "Father, forgive Neil. He knows not what he does." And we've got to put our name in there. To be able to somehow or other have some little bit of understanding, just a little bit of understanding of what it meant. The crucifixion, your lungs, you suffocate. During this time, he didn't call on God to bring down the fire to destroy or whatever it might be. No, he called out, "Father, forgive them," as Luke 23:34. They don't know what they do. What did the thief on the cross see that caused change to come into this condemned man's life? What did he see? Mark 15:32 says, "Even those who were crucified with him reviled him." Now, one thief turns to the other and says, I want you to have a look with me in Luke 23. Friend, this is not a game we play. This is not just something we do on a Sunday. This is not some club. It's not some place. But it's somewhere or other catching a glimpse. Catching a glimpse, and I realize this centurion soldier and this thief on the cross caught a glimpse of something that changed them. And I don't know about you, but I want to be changed. I want somehow or other that God can change me and I can get rid of pride and whatever else I need to get rid of. Verse 39. And one of the criminals who were hanging blasphemed him, saying, "If you are the Christ, save yourself and us." But the other answered, rebuking him, saying, "Do you not even fear God, seeing you are under the same condemnation? And we indeed justified, for we received the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said to Jesus, "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said to him, "Assuredly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." What did the thief see? What did Freddie see that day when most probably in his own life everything looked like as it was upside down, wrong way up? Shaking his fist even at God, he said, "What is going on?" He knew enough about God most probably to know that God existed. But then the love of God somewhere or other got inside of him and changed his life forever. How many people want to be changed forever? I believe that the thief saw the reality of redemption, which a lot of people in church never see. The reality of redemption. Because sometimes we don't see, because we have a nice little polished cross. We have a Jesus hanging there sometimes with a loincloth around him. But I believe that God, if you could just open our eyes to the reality of it, to see what this thief saw, he would have seen the wounds. He would have seen the blood pouring out of his body. The thieves, you see, they were bound with ropes or whatever in those days to the cross. But Jesus was nailed to the cross. The nails weren't some stainless steel, nice little nails. They would have been drop forged. They would have been rough. They would have tore into his flesh, as his hands would have been just torn apart as those nails were driven in. The blood would have just oozed out of him. His feet, as they put them together and drove that nail right through their feet. Blood just oozing out as the blood from the crown of thorns that they'd put onto his head, as those thorns would have penetrated his flesh, and the blood started running down his face. Friend, I had a little needle put into my eyebrow. Look what it did to me. Jesus had thorns. The blood oozing down his face, mingling with the blood running down his arms, mingling with the blood from the whip that had just opened up his back, and mostly all of his front part of his chest would have been open as well. Blood, blood, blood. And he's looking down looking at Jesus there with all this going on. Back open by the scourge's whip, crown of thorns. But it wasn't just the blood oozing out of him, but it was love for his people. As he cried out, "Forgive them, forgive them." I believe Jesus was in total agony from his wounds. But I believe that his greatest agony would have been the religious crowds, the chief priests and the scribes, mocking him. I wonder today as he looks down upon his church and he sees the church drifting so far away from the reality and his presence and having some sort of a social gospel, I wonder what he feels today. But I believe that the greatest agony would not have been those wounds. It would have been the people that he'd come to die for, mocking him, spitting at him, reviling him, the chief priests. Jesus was driven by his love for us. Friend, we've got to catch something fresh, because it will affect the way you worship. It'll affect the way you come into his presence. We won't just come in, but we'll understand that we're standing on holy ground. When we partake of the communion, we're not just having a cracker and a little bit of wine, grape juice, but we're remembering the greatest victory that humanity will ever face, will ever see. That we will just somehow or other, as we start to sing the songs, he wears the victor's crown. Friend, I tell you what, that song takes on new meaning. The songs of glory take on a new meaning. The songs that we've been singing this morning, Jody had no idea what I was going to be preaching about, but every song has got an impact on what I'm talking about. And as we were singing them, it was just impacting in me because I knew what I was going to be sharing today, and we're singing these songs. You see, Jesus is looking for something. He's looking for a bunch of people that will worship him in spirit and in truth. We're not here to sing lullabies, but we're here to sing and enter into his presence. Amen. The greatest agony would have been what he saw. He was driven by his love for us. We have to hear him say, "Lord, forgive us." You got to see what the thief saw. I believe something else the thief saw, he saw the authority Jesus carried because he called him Lord. Jesus was a servant, but he called him Lord. He saw the authority. The authority's in that anointing. The man that was mocking and cursing him now says, "Lord, remember me." One of the great things that we've got to understand, and I had this message well prepared before we had our breakfast on Saturday, but I just identified Freddie with the thief. 1 minute cursing him, cursing his God, but God loved Freddie so much that he didn't allow that to stop his love from going to Fred. He could have said, "Fred, go to hell." But he didn't. He kept loving him, amen? Until he brought him into that place. Until he brought him into that place where Freddie bowed the knee and let Jesus come into his life. Words of repentance. You know what? Can you imagine? Here's a man hanging on a cross, about to die, saying, "Lord, remember me." You know what? He had nothing to offer, nothing to give, is about to die. Jesus might have said, "Well, what's the use? You're worthless." No, Jesus said to the thief, "Today you will be in paradise with me. Today you will be in paradise with me. Today you will be in paradise with me." Jesus, when he died, he went to a place called Hades. the demons, the torment. Would have been horrific. On the third day, life entered in to this man from Galilee. And he began to stir. And he began to rise. And he walked over. As he rose, I would tell you, every demon in hell would have started to cringe. They would have been saying, he said on the third day he would rise again. He said he would rise again. Oh, could this be it? Could this be it? They would have looked to their master, who now is trembling in fear, because he knew what was coming upon him. He knew that Jesus had paid the price in full. One demon was overheard saying to the other demon, Satan just wet himself. As Jesus walked over to that enemy, as he took him, oh, Rasha Kabundi Nakabande, as he grabbed him with every bit of power he had, and he looked at him eyeball to eyeball, and he said, I'm taking back everything that you stole from Adam. Everything that you stole, and listen to me well and good, boy, I'm going to take the keys of hell and of death, and I'm going to give them to my church, and I'm going to give them the power and the authority and the victory that you stole. It will no longer be yours, but my people, they are going to speak my name with authority, and your demon powers will cringe and they will run in terror, because my church is going to rise. Hallelujah. Friend, if you don't want to rise for yourself, rise up for Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, give him the glory and give him the praise. He stripped him of everything. I don't know if you've ever seen the gridiron players, particularly the guys that run on the wing. I don't know what you call them. What do you call the guys on the outskirts? Those fellas, anyhow. They're as skinny as a stick. They got little legs. You see them like that break off. But they put on this great big thing is, ever seen them? They put on this great thing. I've seen a guy dragging his along, this little skinny fella. He had this thing that's about that wide. He put that on him. Man, I'm scared of him. Get away from him. He took it off and there was nothing there. Ever taken a... French people eat them. They're in the shell. Snail. Ever taken a snail out of its shell? Little dangly thing there, nothing left. And in the shell, it looks big. There's nothing there. And these gridiron players, they take this thing off and there's nothing left of them. And I just saw, as I was praying, I just saw Jesus walk over there, and he had that gridiron thing on that made him look big and tough, and he just tore it off him and left him as the worm of a man that he is. And he gave us power and authority. He gave us the blood and the word and the anointing and the victory. He said this. He said, listen here, devil. Cop this. I'm going back. And I'm going back, and I'm going to empower my church with the mighty Holy Ghost. Ooh, the one that just raised me from the dead. I'm going to go back and I'm going to pour it out all over my church. And they're going to rise up and they're going to kick your butt all the way to hell. Hell's still waiting for him. It's coming, amen. Satan's worst days are ahead of him. The church's best days are ahead of us, amen. What did they see? What did they What do you see? What do you see that will stop us from leading this, the life that we lead, into a dynamic, powerful life for Christ? Friend, we're only here for a season and then eternity, amen. We might as well live for Jesus, amen. Because at the end, there's nothing left but Him. I want you to bow your heads with me. You may be in this house. Musicians can come up if you don't mind. You may be in this house, and I want to ask you this question. Do you have a meaningful relationship with Jesus Christ? You see, the religious people, they had a relationship with God in a sense, but they didn't really know Him. They preached the word, but they didn't understand the word. Otherwise, they would have seen Jesus, because Jesus is all the way through the Old Testament. They would have seen Him. They would have known Him. They would have recognized Him. But they are living for themselves. They are living a carnal life. They are living for their own pleasures. They are living for their own importance. You see, Jesus is the answer. Without Him, we have nothing. Do you have a meaningful relationship with this Jesus that will change your life, that will help you break through into the supernatural? Have you ever given your life to this Jesus? Have you ever surrendered to Him? Or if you have, have you just let it slip by? Have you let some enemy come in and steal it from you? That today is just a memory. See, that Jesus came for the church. He went to the synagogues, He preached, He shared, but they didn't recognize Him. I'm asking you today, how or what do you see? I want to see Jesus. You might be here today and say, I really want to see Jesus. I really want to see Him. I don't really have that meaningful relationship with Him, but I want to see Him today. If you've never given your life to Christ before, and today there's something stirring in your heart, or you've gone away from God and you want to come back to Him. You might have done stupid things. I'm reminded again of Freddie, as he, excuse me for mentioning him all the time, but he was shaking his fist at God, but God says, hey, come on, boy. I got you where I want you. The thief on the cross was blaspheming too and cursing, but now all of a sudden he sees something different. I pray today that you might have seen something that would attract you to this Christ. We're just going to stand. We're going to sing this song. If you're here today and you know perhaps your love for Jesus has gone cold, and you want to fan that flame, you want to see Jesus again in your life, I'm going to ask you to come. Come and stand and give your life to Jesus. You might have been saved many, many years, but then you know that there's something that's missing and you want to come again to the foot of the cross and ask Him to touch you again. He's going to sing this song. This is your opportunity. Thank you.
faith.
Oh, Father God, just pray, my God, right now that you'd have your way. That you'd touch people's lives. Father, we're your people. We want to know you. We want to see what the thief saw and what the centurion soldier saw. We want to be able to just open our hearts to you, my God, and allow your presence to flood into our lives. Oh, my God. Just have your way, Lord. Have your way, my God. He's going to sing this song one more time. If you're in this place today and you might need a touch from God, God might have touched something in your heart today and you just want to say, God, I want to just come back to you, or God, I just want you just to breathe afresh on me. Lord, I'm going through this thing right now and for a moment I lost sight of you. For a period of time I just lost sight of you, my God, and I want you just to touch me again in your power, that I can see you high and lifted up, see you far above every principality and power, seated in heavenly places. Oh my God, just if you're like this while we're singing this song again, you'd like to just come and receive prayer, just come. If God's talking to you, come. Give your life to Jesus, come.